Hello everyone, welcome to the course of heating, ventilation and air conditioning. We are dealing with unit number 1, that is advanced vapor compression cycle. This is lecture number 2 for the unit number 1. Talking about transcritical cycle, in this particular session we will discuss about transcritical cycle. We will see the properties of CO2. Why there is the property of CO2? Because in transcritical cycle, the CO2 is used as a working fluid. Now, next we will see the types of different types of transcritical cycle. We will see the classification and different types of transcritical cycle. Now, next is advantages and disadvantages of transcritical cycle that we will discuss in this session. So, I am Professor Ankit Kumar Mishra, working in Sandeep Institute of Engineering and Management in Department of Mechanical Engineering. So, without wasting our time, let's start the session. So, topic is transcritical cycle. Now, the transcritical cycle means there is two type of cycle. One cycle that works under work below the critical cycle, that is known as a subcritical cycle. The cycle which work above subcritical cycle is known as supercritical cycle, and the cycle which work under subcritical as well as supercritical phase is known as transcritical cycle. So if a cycle is having high pressure above critical pressure of working fluid, then we will call it as a transcritical cycle. The working fluid or refrigerant used in transcritical cycle is carbon dioxide. Now the refrigerating number of carbon dioxide is R744. Why we are using carbon dioxide, or what are the properties of carbon dioxide? So talking about properties of carbon dioxide, it is easily available in our atmosphere. It is about 0.04%. So we can say that the availability of carbon dioxide is easy. Now it can be transported. The solid phase of carbon dioxide is known as a dry ice. Now after formation of dry ice, we can easily transport the carbon dioxide. Talking about thermodynamic property of carbon dioxide, the triple point of a carbon dioxide is at a pressure of 5.2 bar and temperature is minus 56 degree centigrade. Now minus 56 degree centigrade is the temperature that we can achieve. Now talking about critical point, the critical point of the carbon dioxide is 73.8 bar or the temperature is around 31 degree. So if 31 degree is easily available, and at 31 degree if we compress the carbon dioxide up to 73.8 bar, its critical point achieved. So if we are going for transcritical cycle, the obviously we have to go above condenser, the condenser temperature above the saturation line, and the evaporator pressure below the critical point. This is the critical point for any working fluid. For any working fluid, the critical point may be, is always vary. So the critical, above the critical point if the condenser line is drawn, and below the critical point if evaporator line is drawn, then we can say that the system is transcritical cycle. So let's see the transcritical cycle. This is the transcritical cycle. This pH diagram is for transcritical cycle, while this pH diagram is for theoretical VCC, vapor compression cycle, and this is for transcritical. Vapor compression cycle. Now this is a transcritical cycle is working on the same vapor compression cycle. Now if we are talking about vapor compression cycle, as we know, that consists of compressor, then there is a condenser, then there is a condenser and expansion valve and evaporator. Now heat is same working of the vapor compression cycle we can deal with Transcritical cycle. In evaporator, heat is added to the refrigerant. That means heat is added to the CO2. Now that CO2 is going to be transferred to compressor, where it compressed above the critical point, and then it goes to the condenser, where heat is rejected from the gas, and then after it goes to the expansion valve, where again there is a isenthalpic process. So if you see the transcritical cycle pH diagram for the transcritical cycle, it goes something like this: 1 to 2, where work is done on the system. Above critical point, the heat is rejected. Heat is rejected above the critical point in condenser. Then there is an isenthalpic process, 3 to 4, and from 4 to 1, it is goes in evaporator. One thing more about the transcritical cycle: the point number 1 should be in superheated state. But while talking about in theoretical cycle, we can see that the point number 1 is in as a saturated point. So state number 1 is a saturated point, and while state number 2 is superheated point. Okay. Now talking about types of transcritical cycle. Now transcritical cycle, if we are talking about the classification of transcritical cycle, is divided into two parts. That is, first one is nothing but a single stage cycle. That means that we saw earlier, that is nothing but an example of single stage cycle. Now in there is another two stage cycle. In single stage cycle, we are with a throttling valve, or we can use expander, or we can use a suction line heat exchanger. These are the three components that can be used in different ways. So if you are using a throttling valve, you can say that the transcritical cycle, single stage cycle with a throttling valve. Or you can, if you are using expander, you can use expander where there is a power cycle attached with the transcritical cycle, then expander can be used. So if you are using expander, it can be said to be a single stage transcritical cycle with expander. Again, there is, if you are using a heat exchanger in a suction line, we can say it as. Similarly, in two stage cycle, we can use a intercooler. We can use gas bypass, that is flash chamber. We can use a flash chamber, or we can use an internal gas cooler. So these are the things that we are going to discuss today. Let's start with single stage cycle with throttling device. Now that is what I discussed earlier. This is an example. This is the example that shows while describing the transcritical cycle. Now over here, if you are using a throttling valve, then this cycle is known as a single stage with a throttling. Now single stage means that there is one single cycle. Okay. If two pressure is available, if only two pressure is available, then we can say that there is one cycle. That means if there is one higher pressure and one is lower pressure, then we can say that the cycle is single stage cycle. If there is multiple pressure, like higher pressure, lower pressure, and intermediate pressure is also available, then we will say that that is a two stage cycle. Now this can be explained. There is a compressor, this is a gas cooler, throttle valve, and evaporator. This is the pH diagram for this particular cycle. Now talking about with expander. Now with expander means I already said, when there is a power plant, then there is a turbine. Now turbine, by using turbine, one can also run the expander. Suppose if we are not having a turbine, or we are using a simple expander. Now to run the compressor, one can attach electricity. If you are using a reciprocating compressor, one can say that at this time, let's say I'm showing you how the arrangement will be. Now this is the arrangement. When there is a gas is in compressed mode, when this piston moves from this point to this point, we can say that the compression is happened. At the same time, if you see, the expansion will be happen with this point expander. So when there is a compression happened, there is a expanding process happened in expander, while when there is a decompression or the piston moves from this to this point, there is a compression over here. So in this way expander is working. So expander is nothing but a piston cylinder arrangement which can be utilized to give the expansion process in this part. So expansion will be happen during this period when there is a compression happen in compressor. So this can be an arrangement that can be used. If you are talking about the pH diagram, we can see that point number one, state number one is at saturated state, and state from 1 to 2 there is a compression. So obviously there is a compression. One thing more, 2 to 3 there is a heat rejection process. Obviously in condenser there is a heat rejection process. Heat is rejected over here, and due to rejection of heat the temperature is going to be changed from 2 to 3 and from 3 to 4 expansion. Now in expander the enthalpy will not remain constant. You can't say in expansion H3 is equal to H4. No, that is wrong. In expander H3 is not equal to H4. That can be observed here, over here. So if you see there is a certain amount of delta H is available over here. That means enthalpy is going to be increased. Why the enthalpy is going to be increased? Because over here we can see that work is done on the expander. That means earlier in throttling device we can see that there is delta W is equals to 0. But over here there is some amount of delta W. That's why we can see that and that delta W is nothing but H4 minus H3. That delta W is H4 minus H3, and that amount of work is done on the system on the this part of the process 3 to 4. So there we will achieve some amount of work. Now we can see that the COP of the system, can be analyzed or can be calculated by using a formula, again refrigerating effect, that is H1 minus H4 upon H2 minus H1. This is the formula that through which we can calculate the amount of that the performance of this particular cycle. Next is a single stage cycle with suction line heat exchanger. If you see, this is nothing but a evaporator. This is a evaporator. Now after going after the evaporator, we have to superheat the superheat the refrigerant. Now refrigerant is nothing but a CO2. CO2 is used as a refrigerant in transcritical cycle. So the what happened with the CO2? CO2 will get heat from this line. How this line can deliver the heat, we will see later. Now the gaseous part of gaseous form of CO2 will get heat from this part and become a superheated. So 1 to 1 dash, if you see the our heat exchanger, there is a point 1 to 1 dash, and 1 to 1 dash is happened over from this point to this point. So at constant pressure there is a heat addition process. Although from 4 to 1 happened in evaporator, and the heat is added from 4 to 1 point and it becomes saturated. Now 1 to 1 dash is done in heat exchanger, where heat is again further added. Now from 1 dash to 2 there is a compressor. This is a compressor. So 1 dash to 2 there is a reversible adiabatic process for theoretical point of view. Now 1 dash to 2 there is a reversible adiabatic process where work is done on the system. From 2 to 3 one can say that this is a condenser and heat is rejected. Heat is rejected from 2 to 3. Now 3 to 4 there is again, if you see from 3 to 3 dash there is a heat exchanger. Now what happened with this heat exchanger? This heat exchanger lose their heat. If you see the temperature at point number 3 dash, if this you see the temperature of point number 3, the temperature of point number 3 is much higher. This is nothing but a pH diagram. Okay, if you see the temperature at point number C, it is above critical point. So temperature is much higher than point number 1. So if temperature of this portion is higher and the temperature of this portion, point number 1 to 1 dash, is lower, then obviously heat will be flow from high temperature to low temperature. That's why in this heat exchanger the heat is flowing from this portion to this portion. Okay, so after 3 to 3 dash, so you can see that heat is going to be loose. So that again there is a further temperature drop from 3 to 3 dash, and from 3 dash to 4 dash, 3 dash 4, not only 4 dash, it is 4. Okay, from 3 dash to 4, what happened? 3 dash to 4, what happened? There is a again expansion process. So enthalpy will remain constant, because why we are using a thermostatic expansion valve. If we are using a thermostatic expansion valve, expansion enthalpy will remain constant. So if you are using a heat exchanger, you can see that this much amount of COP or refrigerating effect is going to be increased. So while using the purpose of using an heat exchanger, suction line heat exchanger, is to improve the COP of this particular cycle. So after improving the after using the heat exchanger, the COP of the system will be increased. That's why we are using this heat exchanger, and this is another type of single stage cycle. So this is all about the single stage cycle. Let's talk about two stage cycle. Now if you see the two stage cycle, as I earlier said, having a two stage cycle, there must be some intermediate pressure. Now this is evaporator, this is evaporator, this is your condenser, this is condenser. Now there is one pressure over here. This pressure is nothing but a evaporator pressure. One can say that this is condenser, and this condenser pressure is nothing but a this pressure is nothing but a condenser pressure. And between these two, this line shows that there is an intermediate pressure. So we can see that this is our intermediate pressure. Let's discuss about this cycle. Now at point number one, refrigerant is at superheated state. Point number one, refrigerant is at superheated state. It goes to compressor 1, first compressor, where it compressed from 1 to 2. There is a compressor happen and work is done. Now talking about at point number 3 to 4, let's before going to over here, point number, how this point achieve over here, just see, there is a certain amount of energy having point number 2. So point number 2 is having an enthalpy, let's say this is a pH diagram. Okay, now at point number 2, one can say that it is having an enthalpy of H2. Talking about point number 3, so before going to point number 3, we are having a point number 8. Point number 8 is nothing but a 7 and 8. Point number 8 is nothing but a this point. How it comes, I will elaborate later. Now this is the point number 8. Now point number 8 is having an enthalpy of H8. Now obviously from this graph you can see that H8 is less than H2. So if H8 is less than H2 and there is a mixing process, now we know that energy will always conserve. So one can say that the mass of this part, from this part, let's say M2 is coming from this part and M1 is coming from this part, and there is a M3. So the total mass conservation rule, from the mass conservation we can say that M1 plus M2 must be equal to M3. And similarly, we can, from energy conservation, we can say that M1 with H2, H2 amount of heat is at point number 2, plus M2 into H8. Now M2 mass is coming from this line and H8 is its enthalpy. The total energy will be M2 into H8 must be equal to M1 plus M2 into H3. So if you solve this equation, you will come to know that H3 is nothing but a M1 plus M1 H2 plus M2 H8 divided by M1 plus M2, and it will comes between H8 and H2 somewhere. So that's why we are taking point number 3 over here, and from point number 3 to point number 4, we can see that there is a compression process. So again, 3 to 4, there is a work done on the system and there is a compression process. So after that, from point number 4 to point number 5, heat is rejected in condenser. After point number 5, it is divided into, let's say it is divided into M2 and M1. Now M2 goes to the first, M2 goes to the expansion device. It means after going to the M2 to the M2 amount of carbon dioxide in expansion valve, its temperature is going to be decreased, obviously. Now it will goes in a heat exchanger which is having a temperature of higher pressure. So at this point one can say that the temperature is higher from this point, so one can say that this temperature is higher than this temperature, and again heat will be flow. So again from point number 7, this is your point number 7, okay, from point number 7 heat exchanges, that means heat is getting, and heat is getting, that's why the phase of this carbon dioxide is going to be shifted from liquid to vapor phase. Now we will achieve our point number 8 in vapor phase. Okay, talking about this point must be from 5 to 5 dash. Actually it goes to something like this, there should be a 5 dash. Why? Because this point, this refrigerant is going to be lose their heat, so it comes to the 5 dash, and then from 5 dash we will come to the point number 6. This is our point number 6. So this is what happened in this system with a intercooler. Now this heat exchanger is acting like an intercooler. Okay. Next is two stage with flash gas removal. Now flash gas removal is something like this. If you see the flash gas removal in actual apparatus, it consists a liquid refrigerant lying from one part, and second is going to be a vapor part. Okay, so this is what happened in liquid line. Just a second. Okay. This is a example of flash gas removal. You can collect the liquid refrigerant from lower part. Liquid refrigerant can be collected from lower part, while the vapor refrigerant from collected from this part. If I draw this diagram completely, let's say if I draw this part something like this, and we are having a tank. Okay, this is a tank which is filled with a refrigerant. Now if we placed a tube something like this over here, outlet portal, and one is coming with a full dip line. Now this is full dip line, so refrigerant is coming from this part to this part. The vapor part of the refrigerant is going over here. This is the vapor part of the refrigerant. Now vapor part of the refrigerant can be extracted by using this line, and liquid part, liquid plus vapor part is coming from this line, and the liquid line will be going from this line. Over here liquid can be discharged. This is the simple construction of a flash gas chamber. Okay, now talking about flash gas chamber. Flash gas chamber is used over here. Now we can see that again something like intercooler 1 to 2, there is a 1 to 2, there is a compression process. 1 to 2, there is a compression process where work is done on the system. Now 2 to 3, again energy conservation rule and mass conservation rule is applied from this point to this point, 2 to 3, and from 3 to 4, there is another compressor over here, compressor number 2. 1 to 2, there is first compressor. So 3 to 4, there is again compression and work is done on the system. Talking about 4 to 5, heat is rejected in 4 to 5. This is a condenser, heat is rejected over here. Phase of the refrigerant is again going to be changed, same like the earlier. Now from condenser, whatever heat is rejected is utilized to heat the, now this is point number 1, one can see that 1 to 2, now that is utilized to heat the refrigerant that is coming out from the compressor 1. So from point number 2, heat is going to be added. If heat is going to be added, this line should be something like this. Heat is added from this line over here. Now whatever be the heat is added, it comes to be this point, and from in if you apply the mass conservation and energy conservation rule, you will get the point number 3. So 5 is the point at the outlet of condenser. From 5 to 6 we are direct having a single evaporator, single expansion valve, and from point 6 to 1 heat is added in evaporator. So this is nothing but an evaporator. This is the working. One can calculate the COP of this system as a refrigerating effect upon work done. Now refrigerating effect can be calculated by H1 minus H6, while the work done can be calculated at H2 minus H1 plus H4 minus H3. If there is a mass flow, a different mass flow rate, one can say that M1 is the mass flow rate over here, M1 is over here, and M2 is over here. So this is the exact formula for calculating the coefficient of performance of this type of system. Okay. Talking about internal gas cooler, now this is nothing but a flash gas chamber. I already described you the construction of flash gas chamber. So if flash gas chamber is applied, the same thing will be happen. Now this is the state where vapor, actually this line what you see over here is something like this. So at this point we will only getting the vapor form of the carbon dioxide. So vapor form of the carbon dioxide at point number 6 double dash, which shows the vapor form is over here, and which shows this point is 6 double dash. Okay, 1 to 2 there is a compression. So 1 to 2 we can say that 1 to 2 there is a compression. This is point number 2, and after applying the energy conservation and mass conservation rule, we can easily get the point number 3 over here. This is our point number 3. So 3 to 4 there is another compressor which supply the work done. After supplying the work done, there is two work done over here. From 1 to 2 there is one work done, and W1, and from 3 to 4 there is another work done, that is W2. 4 to 5 heat is rejected, again the heat is rejected in condenser in 4 to 5, and we can see that this is nothing but a phase diagram. We can see that the phase is going to be changes from above the critical point in condenser. So 4 to 5 happened over here. Now 5 to 6 there is a throttling valve. So 5 to 6 is a straight line, not an inclined line. This is a straight line. Again 6 to 7 is a straight line. Okay, so one can say that H5 is equals to H6, and H6 dash is equals to H7. So from 5 to 6 there is a one intermediate pressure, up to intermediate pressure it is reacted. Now at this point number 6, you can see this point number 6, there is a two phase mixture. That means liquid CO2 will be also available, and vapor CO2 will be available. Now that is going in this tank. Now vapor will be at upper portion and liquid will deposited at lower portion. The liquid refrigerant is coming downward to the toward the evaporator. So liquid refrigerant, that's why this point is at liquid refrigeration, liquid point, that is liquid saturated liquid point state. So saturated liquid will come toward the point number 7 after passing through the expansion valve 2. Expansion, let's say this is expansion valve 2 and this is expansion valve 1. So after passing through expansion valve 2, liquid refrigerant comes toward the evaporator, and then this cycle is working something like this. Okay, and basically this is the working of two stage cycle with an intercooler gas cooler. Again you can calculate the COP. COP can be calculated by H1 minus H7 multiplying of our mass M1, and work done can be calculated by M1 into H2 minus H1 plus M2 into H4 minus H3. You can find the value of H3 by applying the conservation of mass as well as conservation of energy. ओके, टॉकिंग अबाउट एडवांटेजेस एंड डिसएडवांटेजेस ऑफ ट्रांसक्रिटिकल साइकिल. नाउ एडवांटेजेस ऑफ ट्रांसक्रिटिकल साइकिल इज, फर्स्ट एडवांटेज इज इट्स रेफ्रिजरेटिंग कैपेसिटी. रेफ्रिजरेटिंग कैपेसिटी इज सम हाउ यू कैन से ग्रेटली इम्प्रूव्ड इन ट्रांसक्रिटिकल साइकिल. Now high heat transfer in evaporator and condenser. Now condenser is having a somehow temperature above the critical point, that is much more, and atmosphere having a temperature of atmospheric temperature. So the difference of temperature between that part is relatively very high. So the rate of heat transfer is very good, or instead of best position in condenser. Talking about evaporator, evaporator chamber having a good heat transfer. In contest with CO2, greater pressure drop in expansion devices. We can see that the pressure drop for a property due to the properties of carbon dioxide, the pressure drop, we achieve a good pressure drop in a expansion device. CO2 is a material that is non-corrosive, so non-corrosive with the most material. If you are using a copper tube, or you can use a aluminium tube for a evaporator, that will be okay for CO2. So there is no corrosion. That is a very good advantages. Toxicity and inflammable. So you can see that CO2 is a toxic, but not as much as another substance. So one can say that low toxicity. Toxicity is low. It is inflammable. Carbon dioxide is inflammable. Talking about global warming potential, the it is the properties of carbon dioxide that it has a very low global warming potential. Now talking about the capacity of the system is high, I agree with that, but the disadvantage is this system has a low COP. COP is low. Why the COP is low? Because the rate pressure ratio, the higher pressure to the lower pressure, that ratio is very high, and if you use such a high pressure ratio, then the amount of work done by the compressor is relatively high. So if the amount of work done of the work done by the compressor is high, so then you know that the COP formula is nothing but a refrigerating capacity upon work done. So we are having a good refrigerating effect, but the work done in this system is relatively very high. So that's why we are getting a low COP. The low COP is one of the factor disadvantages of this system. Talking about another disadvantages, the second disadvantage is a special compressor is required, as we are using a CO2 and we are going for very much the pressure ratio, as I discussed earlier, the pressure ratio of this system is very high. That's why we required a special type of compressor to compress the CO2 up to above the critical pressure. So that's why this system is having a requirement of a special compressor. Third disadvantage is the complex system. The system is very much complex because we are dealing with a super critical temperature and pressure in addition with a subcritical temperature or subcritical pressure. So if you are going for a supercritical and subcritical both in a same system, it requires a special compressor and the energy loss system to maintain its heat and stability of the entire system, the system become complex. So this is one more. Now carbon dioxide, if you are talking about carbon dioxide, it is very sensitive to the water contaminants. Contamination. That means if we releasing at above the supercritical pressure, if the CO2 is released, then that means it will directly attract the water molecules and it mix with the water particles. That is one of the major drawback of this particular system or the CO2 for this system. That means we have to use this system with a moisture free environment or moisture free condition. Okay. Next is this system is not having a good performance, as we see that the COP is very low. So that we can say that this system is poor system and also having a less reliability. We can't rely on this system very much. although this system, the biggest drawback of this system is its pressure. We have to achieve a pressure above critical pressure. So that is the biggest disadvantage of this system. So because we this system works on very high pressure, so that is the disadvantage of this system. So we learned in this lecture, we learned transcritical cycle. We see what are the different types of transcritical cycle. We also see the pH and TS diagram of that cycle, pH diagram of that cycle, how the cycle work. We see the construction or working of that particular transcritical cycle, as well as we see how to calculate the COP of that cycle. Then after, we also see the advantages and disadvantages of this cycle. This cycle has having certain advantages, while the disadvantage also having many disadvantages. So this is the conclusion of this particular session. I hope you like this session. Thank you.